हम सबको मुबारकबाद. मैं आई वॉन्ट टू टॉक स्पेसिफिकली अबाउट मैस्कुलिनिटी एंड नेशनलिज्म. हालांकि हम जेंडर की बात करते हैं, लेकिन जेंडर का असली मतलब होता है एक रिश्ता बिटवीन मैन एंड वुमेन, बिटवीन मैन एंड मैन, बिटवीन पीपल हु डोंट रिकॉग्नाइज देमसेल्व्स एज अदर मैन एंड वुमेन. सो आई वॉन्ट टू जस्ट ब्रीफली प्रोवाइड a non-theoretical history of masculinity and nationalism from the end of 19th century to now. So I will begin with some brief comments about the connection between nationalism and masculinity, and end with what I want to call what I want to refer to in the current what's happening to masculinity now, the idea of the strong man as the political leader of the country, and how do we understand current forms of masculinity. And so let me just begin, and I won't read out like Brinda. I just have these in order to just prompt myself. So I think it's important to understand nationalism not only as a political project, not simply and straightforwardly as a political project, but as a cultural project. So my discussion as a sociologist is about the cultural project of nationalism. और फिर मर्दानगी को nationalism के साथ कैसे जोड़ के देखा जाए, इसके बारे में थोड़ा मैं बोलना चाहता हूँ. So firstly then, why study masculinity, right? Why would you not just be satisfied with what feminism has taught us about patriarchy? Let me begin by saying that masculinity is a relationship not only between men and women, but also between men and men. And that is what men need to recognize, that whereas patriarchy produces all men as superior to all women, masculinity is a process of producing some men as superior to not only all women but also to some men, right? And that is a crucial difference. So masculinity studies that is inspired by feminism is then an attempt to look at the relationship not only between men and men but also not only the relationship between men and women but also men and men, because there are men, for example, if you only have daughters, you may not be considered as man enough as someone who has sons, and hence that's of particular significance to certainly to our part of the world. If you don't work, for example, you may not be as man enough as someone who works. If you don't have, in quotation marks, control over your house, जैसे कि आप अपने, मैं ये सब quotation marks में डाल रहा हूँ कि अपने घर की औरतों के ऊपर आपका अगर आपको काबू नहीं है, तो you're not as masculine as someone else who has control over his the women of the house. And that is why it is important to think about masculinity as a particular kind of gender position, as a relationship which has historically for our country at least has had a very significant relationship with nationalism. And let me try and explain just a few points. Okay. So as someone has pointed out, if you really want to understand the field of power in which women have lived their lives as gendered beings, then it's important also to understand men as gendered beings. Otherwise, you produce manhood, maleness as a universal category. Right? You don't interrogate how is it, what investments that men have in building certain kinds of relationship with each other. How do they protect those investments? So it is for these reasons that I think it's really significant and important to study gender. As you know, for example, the gender politics of Indian modernity and nationalism has been studied in terms of has been studied as if women equal gender, which is a fair enough act, which is a fair enough historical trajectory, because after all, feminism has come has derived its impetus in many significant ways from activism. So in a similar way that we've studied ideas about, for example, chastity, ideas about tradition, ideas about home, ideas about the kinds of spaces that men belong, the kind of spaces that women occupy, we should also apply the same lens to the ideas of masculinity. Now, before I say anything, I think it's really important to understand that, you know, people often say, "Kare, to theek hai, you know, if men have certain spaces, after all, women also have their spaces, right?" So we often tend to equate something called masculinity, something called femininity, as equal and opposite terms. They are not equal and opposite terms. So the manner in which masculinity, manhood, gets defined is because the manner in which something called femininity has been defined. So it's only if you define femininity as something that is supportive of certain kinds of masculinity that masculinity emerges as a superior category. So masculinity and femininity are not equal and opposed terms. They are in hierarchical relationship to each other. And that's also why it is important to think about how we understand this thing called masculinity, mardangi, alag-alag bhashaon mein alag-alag shabd hain. Now, of course, as I said, so there are different kinds of masculinities, and the masculinity that there are, and usually the term that is used, masculinities, there's no one masculinity, right? There are different kinds of masculinities. There are heterosexual masculinities. There are non-heterosexual masculinities that have relationship to each other. And there, as Binda was saying, there, and it's also then important to think about other terms, other concepts such as sexuality, and how to think about these things within the context of nationalism. How to think about sexuality in the context of masculinity and nationalism. So a very brief history, which will take me about 2 to 3 minutes, would be that so we've always had histories of masculinity in India. There were pre-colonial histories of masculinity. Martial masculinity which existed during the Mughal court, for example. Then you have very specific colonial histories of masculinity, right? So after 1857, certain groups, as I'm sure many of you know, were produced through the colonial power as martial races, not only in India but around the world. So Sikhs and Gurkhas after 1857 became produced as martial races, and of course these were often groups that were seen to have supported the British during the 1857. So other groups such as Bengalis, for example, as you know, were produced as non-masculine and effeminate groups. It is also important to think about masculinity, nationalism, sexuality. Well, not only because, as we know, there are 3,000 condoms that are found every day in JNU. So, and I am actually, frankly, disappointed in all of you. But anyway, let's leave that aside. And it's also important to think about it because a great deal of the connection between masculinity and nationalism that comes about derives from the colonial period in order to produce a certain kind of person who the heterosexual national male hero who takes on certain burdens that the British had themselves introduced in the colonial sphere. So section 377 was also a kind of masculine anxiety about about a loss of the masculine self. So there's a masculine self, the male self has sex with another man, that then quite clearly that self becomes, or one of that self becomes feminized self, right? So it's important to think about how these ideas then become built in into the national sphere. Think now about the post-colonial period. I just want to invoke for you one particular figure. Most of you are very young, younger. Most of you perhaps don't watch black and white films in the 1950s and 60s. But if you look at one particular kind of nationalist figure in the 50s and 60s, he was usually a doctor, an engineer, a dam builder, right? Someone you could call the five-year plan hero. There was a guy who was really the five-year plan hero. Why? Because he embodied certain notions of masculinity and science. You know, like I did economics, my BA and MA. So when I discovered sociology and social anthropology, I think at least for my parents, at least even for my grandmother, that was the real loss of my own masculinity. But they said, you know, for God's sake, that economics has some amount of maths. You know, what does sociology offer? So disciplines are also masculine disciplines. And that is why, for example, the five-year plan hero was always a scientist, right? He was a saver. He saved the nation. He saved for the nation. He built dams. He was a doctor. He was never a consumer. And that's been the great shift in the nationalist hero now. The nationalist hero now, the enemy of the nation now in Indian popular culture is the saver, not the consumer. The hero of the nation now is the consumer. Okay, so while, as I said to you, what happens in the colonial period, that this notion of a self-perception of effeteness, that Indians were effete people, as the British said, was accepted by the Indian nationalists. So many people, such as the Dayanand Saraswati, Vivekananda, for example, propagated the idea that indeed Indians, there is evidence that we are not a sort of a feminine people, and that we need to become more masculine. And these ideas then become built into our nationalist discourse. However, at the same time, if you remember, if you think of things like the Parsi theatre, the Marathi theatre, the most significant roles were, not the most significant roles, but almost all the roles of women were done by men. And this is not only because women were not allowed to do it. Many scholars have pointed out that there's often amongst the audience a preference, like an autoeroticism, for men, so performing women's roles. And one of the most, Bal Gandhar was of course one of the most popular, popular performers in the Parsi and Marathi theatre tradition. His images were in on coasters and handkerchiefs and matches, etc., etc. So there was also a preference for male performers who would perform women's roles. And it's important to think about what happens to that particular tradition. I'm not arguing that this is like a utopia of feminism of some sort, but I'm certainly suggesting that it's worthwhile thinking about the complexities of the kinds of gender identity that nationalism takes on board much later on. Now, let me then think about some of the topics that we all, nationalism is about and has been discussed with you in the last week or so, last 10 days. One is the idea of religion, masculinity, and nationalism. Okay, many of the 19th century upper caste Hindu nationalists came to believe that the emasculation, again I put this in inverted commas, of the Hindu people was in fact due to the long history of Muslim rule. And that this had to be an earlier pre-colonial masculinity had to be resuscitated, that had to be got back. So religion has always been a very significant aspect in which masculinity and nationalism in India have come together, and you can hear echoes of this now. It's not anything new. Let me also then speak very briefly about caste. What happens in Maharashtra in the early 20th century is a very strong eugenics movement, right? And Maharashtra was actually a very interesting place because there was a very strong sexology movement, very strong eugenics movement, and many people started writing about eugenics, saying why eugenics is a good thing. And there the idea was that you must also remember in that part of India, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, there were also very strong anti-Brahmanical movements, right? So a lot of the eugenics movement that happens in Maharashtra and parts of Tamil Nadu, and many people start to justify saying why eugenics is necessary, gets built around one particular term that I remember one author, a Marathi author called N.S. Farke, using, was sexual swaraj. He said, we need eugenics because it proves that our caste system has historically been a scientific way of organizing human society. That's what eugenics is. And we must also remember that at that particular point in time, there was, as I said, strong anti-caste movement. So the defense of the eugenics movement, which is also a defense of the caste system, was also a particular kind of masculine anxiety, upper caste masculine anxiety about the movements that are happening, that were happening against caste at that particular point in time. So there was a real concern about what is to be the nature of Indian masculinity after Swaraj is achieved. And this was a very serious and very, very detailed argument that was happening in many parts of Maharashtra. I've already talked about sort of in the post-colonial period, what happens is one figure that becomes a strong nationalist figure is the five-year plan hero. Also, let me point out to you one particular aspect that most of you remember the heroes of the 1950s and 60s. So if you remember heroes like Dilip Kumar, for example, if you remember heroes like even when Raj Kapoor, not in his younger days but later, most of these heroes of Hindi film heroes 1950s and 60s, if you think about what masculinity means now, did not actually look like masculine figures. They were not muscular, right? And they were in fact quite portly, and I think there's a specific reason for that, which has again to be linked to how that particular kind of five-year plan hero was also linked to caste, because to be muscular in 1950s and 60s would mean someone who worked with their hands, right? To be lean would mean someone who worked with their hands. So the natural default position of the five-year plan hero, which everyone automatically recognized, was as an upper caste person, because you had to look as if you did not work with your hands. So the different cultural ways in which nationalism, masculinity have been really significant in the life of this nation. The five-year plan hero, as you know, kind of declines in the late 1970s with the rise of Amitabh Bachchan as the lean hero, as the anti-state hero, as the provincial man who comes to the city to take part in parts of consumption. Let me now come to the present, because I want to end as quickly as possible, so that if you would like any points of discussion, perhaps we can have that. I want now to point to the current state. How do we understand masculinity and nationalism? Let me refer to this particular way of looking at masculinity as Modi masculinity. By which I mean that, firstly, the five-year plan hero is gone. So the notion of the national hero will save for the nation, that has gone. So you have now a rise of consumer culture. You have, and consumerism is that process where everyone is invited to consume, right? Men, women, so capital doesn't care, right? And yet, historically in India at least, the woman has never been the consumer, right? She's always been, cultural discourse, always been the sacrificer, someone who will eat after the brothers and fathers have eaten, someone who will save for the nation, who will never consume, right? So consumerism is also a period where, which invites everyone to consume, and yet it also causes a certain kind of masculine anxiety, because the consuming woman in the Indian context is a very new figure, right? The woman who spends on herself, the young woman who hangs out in shopping malls, the woman who will who earns and spends for herself, the working woman, as Binda was pointing out. Now, I think what the current, the manner in which we could perhaps try and think about masculinity and nationalism in terms of what I've referred to as bodhi masculinity, is the rise of a figure who promises both the world, but also control over the home. So no one does not want consumption, no one does not want more fridges, cars, overseas travel, and I think the strong political figure now that we have, and you remember in the election campaign, even his opponents started to talk about him in terms of his masculineness, only if only to dispute him. I remember, I think Salman Khurshid said once that he was actually a napunsak, impotent man, because he could not stop the Gujarat riots. So even whilst people were trying to oppose Narendra Modi in his election campaign, they were actually discussing him in the coin that his own party wanted him to be discussed. So they were discussing him as more or less masculine, but masculine nevertheless, right? So I think what we have right now is a particular kind of connection between masculinity and nationalism in the form of the strong political leader who says, I will give you the world, but simultaneously, I will make sure that Indian traditions are maintained. So you can be a person of the world, but also maintain control over the home. So I think that's another way perhaps we might think about how in the current period, what the relationships are between masculinity and nationalism. And that particular discourse, you know, also appeals not only to Indians within India, but also diasporic Indians. The notion of, so, I think what the current form of masculinity does is combines a deterritorialized nationalism, you can be a global Indian citizen, but also reinforces all those very ideas of tradition, chastity, and man controlling the home that have been with us for a long time. So it's not, so I'm not giving you a sort of a straight linear history of masculinity and nationalism, but to think about how do older ideas come back to us? How do older ideas become reinvented in a new context? So how do we understand the connection between masculinity and nationalism in the current period, which is not characterized by the savings ethic, right? My parent generation, perhaps many of your parent generation. How do we think about nationality in the context where the consumer is the national hero? And yet, that consumerism, as I said to you, also causes certain forms of masculine anxieties about women, the woman as a consumer. So how do you tackle that at the level of the culture? So that, how do you say that you can have the world, because that's what it is to be global, but also we will not allow that globalism, we will not allow those various flows and processes that are part of globalism to threaten your control of the home. So just to end then, I think what I've referred to as Modi masculinity offers both the possibilities of worldliness, but also the idea that within this new nationalism, men may control to have control of the home. So these are just some of the ways I think it's important to think of nationalism as a cultural project, because ultimately nationalism falls out when it appeals to people. It is on the cultural sphere, right? It's not so much that people actually sit down and talk about the economics of nationalism or the politics of nationalism. They do that. But the most frequent discussions around tea shops, around in homes, in classrooms, in your hostel rooms, etc., is about how culturally to understand what is this thing called nationalism. So I'll end with saying that I think perhaps one of the current ways of thinking about nationalism is that we must think about the connection that is increasingly made between offering you the world, by you, I mean men in particular, but also offering you that promise that you may control to you may continue to control the home. That's all.